Recorded Books and RB Digital present Active Measures by Marc Cameron, narrated by Pete Bradbury. Prologue. November 29th, 1962. Santiago de Cuba. Colonel Miguel de la Guardia knew well the white bone of war. He'd watched his friends be blown into pieces, seen women defiled and children burned. But never in his life had he witnessed anything so heartbreaking as this convoy driving out of the forest. Across Cuba, under cover of darkness, other commanders stood and wept in similar clearings at the unfolding of the same sad event. History would judge the Russians for this insult. Of that, Colonel de la Guardia was certain. The Soviet Union had once believed in the revolution. For 59 glorious days, Cuba had been a nuclear power. Fidel was able to shake his fist at the American president, secure in the knowledge that if push came to shove, he could repel an invasion by the imperialist and render the stolen base at Guantanamo Bay a glowing pit of radiation. But no more. Khrushchev, the once loyal Soviet older brother, had decided this was not to be. Cuba was too young and impetuous to be trusted with nuclear weapons. De la Guardia squared his shoulders, steeling himself against despair. 8 Maz trucks squealed and groaned in the darkness, pulling heavy trailers out of the clearing and disappearing into the forest. The hulking trucks ran without headlights, security against American attack. 4 KS-19 100mm air defense guns would be the last to roll away. One could never be too careful. Yankee spies were thick as weeds on the island. Cuba had won the revolution, but the war with the U.S. smoldered on, and the Russians had still decided to abandon them. Colonel de la Guardia stood ramrod straight in the purple shadow of an abandoned poultry house. He was flanked by his driver and one of his aides. Both were mere boys, barely a decade older than his own son. In their late teens, they had more than once proven themselves fiercely devoted to the revolution, and more important, to de la Guardia. The colonel had zero doubt that, had it been light enough to see, tears of abject sadness would have been apparent on the young men's exhausted faces. Dozens of men coughed and cursed in the blackness of night, tired, and like their commander, despondent to the point of weeping. Kits rattled, wooden crates thudded against one another. Even the trucks seemed to register the wrongness of what they were doing. Springs squeaked and gears groaned in protest as they disappeared down deeply rutted roads. The last 6 FKR tactical nuclear missiles were leaving the island. The idiot Yankees had chewed their collars over medium and intermediate range missiles in Cuba, but they'd had no idea about the short range weapons the Soviets had deployed right under their noses. Then Khrushchev had decided he wanted all his missiles back, along with the 4 Soviet regiments meant to operate them. It was all de la Guardia could do to hold his head upright. A tall man with the chiseled look of an American film star, he was a son of the revolution, proud of his close friendship with the Comandante, though he didn't care much for that blowhard Ernesto Che Guevara. Colonel de la Guardia did not fear death, but this Soviet insult was far worse. To be weak was one thing, but to know real power and then have it stolen by those who profess to be your friends, that was emasculating. At a sudden crunch in the gravel, his training took over and brought him out of his moping. His hand dropped the Makarov pistol at his side.
"Ah, there you are, comrade colonel," Major Vasily Kapuchin said.
There was no moon, but intermittent brake lights and the periodic flash of torches were enough to illuminate Kapuchin's smile. His world had not turned upside down.
"Do not look so glum, my friend," the major said. "All is not lost. This is not the end of everything."
"I do not blame you, Comrade Vasily," de la Guardia said, "but I fear that you are wrong."
De la Guardia's counterpart in the Soviet forces in Cuba, Kapuchin was the de facto man in charge of the regiment tasked with the FKRs pointed at the American base at Guantanamo Bay. The Russian was only a major, but it was an unspoken truth that a Soviet major outranked a Cuban colonel by exponential proportions. De La Guardia sighed, attempting to remind himself that his friend was in fact guiltless. Major Capuchin was only following orders from the Presidium of the Supreme Soviet, but as the one tasked to oversee the logistical details of the missile removal, did he not bear some responsibility for leaving Cuba vulnerable to another Yankee invasion? The Russian put a hand on De La Guardia's shoulder and gave it a brotherly squeeze. A nearby truck hit its brakes, and for a brief moment a line of perfect teeth gleamed under a thick salt-and-pepper mustache. Had it been any other Soviet, De La Guardia would have been tempted to cut his hand off with a machete.
"Come with me, my friend," Capuchin said.
He nodded toward the hulk of the farthest poultry barn, some 100 meters away. They were all abandoned, but the ammonia smell of chicken manure still hung like razor blades on the humid air.
"There is something I want to show you."
De La Guardia groaned. He'd been awake for over 36 hours. There was little point in doing anything other than finding a bed. Still, he followed dutifully, motioning for his aide and his driver to accompany him with a flick of his hand. Capuchin nodded to the two younger men before looking back at De La Guardia to raise a wary eye.
"Do you trust these men?"
"Without question," De La Guardia said. "They would die for me."
Both boys puffed their chests at the show of trust from the colonel.
"Ah," Capuchin said, "dying is often the easy part."
The boys glared at the Russian.
De La Guardia gave a wan smile in spite of himself.
Capuchin had been a boy during the siege of Stalingrad. Two pimple-faced teenagers could hardly intimidate him.
"Comrade Fidel trusts them," De La Guardia said.
This returned the smug grin to the boys' faces and put the matter to rest once and for all.
"As you wish."
Capuchin turned on his heels. 20 minutes later, Colonel Juan de la Guardia emerged from the poultry barn, smiling for the first time in a week. He inhaled deeply, oblivious to the stench of ammonia. The night air was immeasurably sweeter than it had been only moments before. He wanted to sing, but he thought better of it. There were still too many soldiers loading gear and supplies. A Soviet jeep rattled up and screeched to a stop. The driver, a young lieutenant named Ivchenko, gave Capuchin a crisp salute. The major turned to De La Guardia and extended his hand.
"My car is here."
De La Guardia smiled.
"You must stay and celebrate with me."
"As far as my people know," Capuchin said, "there is nothing for us to celebrate. Day after tomorrow, my ship departs Mariel Harbor for Severomorsk with the last of our special weapons. There is much to do before we leave."
De La Guardia gripped the other man's hand in both fists. Tears welled in his eyes. It was an uncharacteristic display of emotion in front of his staff, but he didn't care.
"You are a true comrade of the revolution," he said. "I do not know what to say."
Capuchin gave him a soft smile.
"Whatever it is, it would be better if you said it to Castro. He should know that there are those of us who believe in your cause, strongly enough to leave one of our little girls behind."
The major often referred to his missiles as females. The FKRs in particular were little girls.
"And what if Fidel decides to utilize your gift sooner rather than later?" De La Guardia asked.
Capuchin shrugged.
"Then someone will be shot," he said. "And that someone will very likely be me. As I told you, given the right circumstances, dying is not so difficult."
"Very well."
De La Guardia almost bounced with pent-up excitement.
"I need to see to my men here and make a quick telephone call to my wife.
Then I will follow you back to Havana on the next flight so I can inform Comandante Fidel in person. The Americans are everywhere. This is not the sort of information one sends via unsecure lines."
The prospect of a bullet to his neck still lingered in Vasily Capuchin's mind as he fastened his lap belt in the Antonov An-2 45 minutes later. The Anushka biplane took off from Antonio Maceo Airport south of Santiago and made a lumbering turn back to the northeast over the dark expanse of tree-choked hills below and unlit homes. Tensions with the United States were high, but it was the lack of electricity in these rural areas that kept them blacked out, not attention to security. The major leaned his forehead against the window, half thinking he might see the shadow of his friend's jeep speeding along the silver-gray road on its way to the airport. What he saw instead caused his breath to catch hard in his throat. Orange flames 1,000 feet below sent a spiraling plume of sparks and smoke into the night air. Capuchin kept his eyes glued to the scene, but barked over his shoulder to Lieutenant Ivchenko. "Check with the pilots," he said. "Find out what they're hearing on the radio." The Anushka carried only 12 passengers, so Ivchenko crossed only a short distance before reaching the cockpit and leaning inside, shoulder deep. 2 minutes later, he made his way back down the narrow aisle, bearing news. "A Cuban convoy has been attacked coming out of the forest." Capuchin gave a weary groan. "Our missiles? The weapons are already passed." As he spoke, Ivchenko bowed his head, then glanced upward like a guilty child. "The assassins were killed." "Good," Capuchin said. "What else?"
"I am very sorry to inform you, Comrade Major, but it appears that Colonel Miguel de la Guardia's jeep was hit by a rocket-propelled grenade. There were no survivors."
Capuchin rubbed his eyes with a thumb and forefinger. War in one part of the world or another was all he'd ever known. A man might get used to bloodshed, but good friends were hard to come by. Ivchenko patted the headrest in front of the Capuchin, half turning to go.
"I will tell the pilot to return to Santiago."
The major thought for a moment, then shook his head.
"No, Lieutenant," he said. "Our mission is before us, not behind."
The young man protested.
"If Colonel de la Guardia was killed, what of the weapon?"
The Antonov banked west toward Havana and away from the fireball. With nothing but black out the window again, Capuchin turned in his seat to fully face the lieutenant.
"My dear Peter," he said through a tight smile, "the records of inspection and the ship's bill of lading show all of the missiles accounted for. I will personally sign off on them when our ship reaches Severomorsk. There is no time to tell Castro directly. Honestly, apart from you, I trust no one but Colonel de la Guardia with information about a nuclear device that should not be in Cuba in the first place."
Ivchenko chewed on his bottom lip, then cocked his head to one side.
"She is well hidden. Perhaps she's lost for good. It may not be until you and I are bones in the ground, but mark my words. Someone will find her," Capuchin said. "The little girl I left behind will not stay hidden forever."
Present day, Florida Straits. Freedom lay off the bow, close enough to smell. Alejandro Plasencia had never ridden a wild horse, but he had flown a MiG-23. This sleek Bahamian cigarette boat slamming against the waves of a confused sea was surely a close approximation of both. The vessel shot through the ink-black night as if fired from a cannon, sending up a chattering spray that drenched everyone on board. Alejandro's wife, Savina, sat on the floor of the boat. One slender hand gripped their small daughter, while the other held a wooden effigy of Alegua, the Santeria deity that her godmother had given her. 2-year-old Umbelina squirmed and whined, trying to escape her mother's python grip, but Savina looked forward, chin up, the outline of her oval face barely visible in the darkness. Alejandro was sure she was smiling. The Cuban ran a hand over his spray-drenched hair and crouched deeper into the back of the cigarette boat. He felt incredibly small on the great black sea. Alejandro estimated that they must be crossing the Gulf Stream by now. Umbelina giggled at the pounding ride, misreading her father's terror for excitement. Their captain, a slender Haitian man named DeVoe, sat behind the wheel, a black silhouette against a blacker night. Only the glow of his cigarette, whipped into an orange coal by the wind, illuminated his face. Ocean currents pushed the waves in a great arc to the northeast, while prevailing winds blew due north across the water, muddling the seas and adding to the chop. Alejandro had once been a pilot, flying a MiG-23 for the 2661st Attack Squadron at San Antonio de los Baños. One of his commanders, observing that Alejandro had the mind of a scientist, had recommended him for the prestigious Aerospace Engineering University of Moscow. It meant no more money. Everyone in Cuba, except for politicians and generals, made essentially the same salary. But his mother could brag about his education, and he got a place to live with floors that were not completely uneven. So that was something. Plasencia did the calculations for speed and drift in his head, praying DeVoe had made the necessary course corrections. He would have said something, but the sullen Haitian didn't invite idle talk. The captain had hardly spoken 10 words since he'd picked them up just after midnight on the Bahamian rock known as Cayo de Sal, Salt Cay. The tiny chain of uninhabited islands was a well-known stopover for balseros. The desperate souls fleeing Cuba on flimsy homemade rafts cobbled together with inner tubes or blocks of styrofoam. Alejandro had first considered hiring one of the human smugglers from Mexico who helped Cubans escape the island, but the going rate for one of these lancheros had been somewhere around $10,000 American before the smuggling of Cuban baseball superstars to the U.S. had inflated the fare to more than $200,000 per person. Even with his side job driving rich Canadian and European tourists around Havana, Alejandro knew he could never afford that price for his entire family. And no one would front him the money because he didn't have a lucrative sports contract waiting on the other end. It was just as well, though. He'd heard that many lancheros had ties to Mexican drug cartels. Subjecting his little family to the dangers of the sea seemed far better than chancing a double-cross or ransom scheme of the violent Satis drug cartel. But he had to leave. There was no question about that. In the end, he split the difference and piloted his own small rubber raft as far as Salt Cay, meeting DeVoe to take them the remainder of the way. The United States Coast Guard made regular patrols of Salt Cay, but the approaching hurricane seemed to be keeping them in ports back home, preparing for the rescue work ahead. The Cuban Coast Guard had their own fast boats, but the same storm was predicted to shave the northern coast, so most of these patrol crafts had fled to the south, on the Bay of Pigs side of the island. In fact, Alejandro and his family had encountered no other vessels since slipping away from the island. Most people who were caught fleeing Cuba, traitors to the revolution, the government called them, were thrown in prison for re-education. Alejandro would be shot. In truth, he'd thought about leaving for more than a decade. He'd just been too much of a coward to follow through until now. Cubans were a beautiful people, his people. But Cuba was an island of smoke and mirrors, garish, flaking paint over rotten wood and rusted metal. Revolution had once appealed to him, as he supposed it did to all young men of conscience. He and his friends were proud Fidelistas. They hated the Yankees and their wicked capitalist ideology with a righteous purity that astounded even their communist parents. He had been a child during the Periodo Especial, the special period of rationing and shortages that followed the Soviet abandonment in 1989. Creeping over the wall of the Havana Zoo with his father to liberate the peacocks from their cages had seemed a great adventure. He'd been too young to understand the desperation his parents had felt when having to eat zoo animals and the unnamed meat that he found out much later was feral cat. It had been easy to blame the problems of the special period on the Yankees. Communism seemed a wise enough notion when that was all he knew. But the older he got, the more he saw. The more he saw, the wider his eyes began to open. A beautiful woman didn't have to beg to be courted. The government shouldn't force you to believe. Then he'd been allowed to leave the island for an engineering conference in Chile. If capitalism was so bad, why were those who lived under its wicked umbrella so happy? The greedy residents of Valparaiso had bread and meat in their grocery stores. The new vehicles that teamed along the avenidas had plenty of fuel. Bit by bit, Alejandro's notion of what was right and what was wrong began to shift. He hated the rich turistas he drove around in his cab, not because they were bourgeois, but because they didn't want his island to change. "We had to come here before progress ruined you," they said. Alejandro knew the hardships of the ancient cars and broken streets that they called quaint. He'd finally decided to leave in the coming December, after hurricane season was well behind them, but Zayda de la Guardia, Major General of the Intelligence Directorate, had summoned him to Santiago, and Alejandro's fate was sealed on the day he'd arrived. Even if he did exactly what they ordered, he would eventually be killed. Death was the way men like General de la Guardia kept secrets. It was the way of things in this quaint island paradise. Alejandra was able to slip away from de la Guardia's staff and catch a flight from Santiago back to Havana, where he picked up his family without being arrested. The small inflatable boat was hidden in the mangroves near the resort beaches of Cayo Blanco, where his contact had said it would be. They left under cover of darkness, and using Alejandro's mobile phone as a GPS, navigated the 50 kilometers across Nicholas Channel to the Kaisal banks. To Alejandro's astonishment, Captain DeVoe had been waiting at the agreed-upon spot. When he finally saw the winking lights of Marathon Key on the horizon, the Cuban's throat convulsed. The wet-foot, dry-foot policy of the United States had changed in recent years, making asylum nearly impossible. Balseros who were lucky enough to make it onto dry land before arrest had once been able to remain in America as refugees. Now they were routinely sent back to Cuba. But Alejandro had seen things. Surely the Yankees would welcome his family with open arms when they heard what he had to say. DeVoe slowed the cigarette boat a mile offshore. The following wake shoved the stern as it caught up with them, causing the boat to wallow in the sea and throw everyone forward. Savina looked up in alarm. Alejandro gave a forced smile to the captain, hoping to conceal his fear.
"Everything is okay?" he asked in accented English.
DeVoe had made it abundantly clear that he didn't speak Spanish.
"Tout bon," the captain said, a freshly lit cigarette clenched between his teeth. He nodded toward the side of the boat. "Off you get."
Alejandro drew his wife and child closer now. The air was hot and muggy, but he had to concentrate to keep his teeth from chattering.
"Off?"
A sudden gust of wind extinguished DeVoe's cigarette. The flame of his lighter showed the look of cruel indifference on his face as he puffed the cigarette back to life. He cupped his hand over the new coal to shield it, shrugging.
"I have no wish to see the walls of an American prison," he gave an impatient flick of his wrist. "So as I said to you before, off you get."
Alejandro was taller, stronger, and had much more to lose. DeVoe seemed to read his mind and drew a black pistol from his pocket.
"But it is too far," Alejandro stammered. "We will drown."
DeVoe gave a deep belly laugh, looking like the pirate that he was.
"J'en doute," he sneered. "I doubt that. You Cubans are, how do you say, les cafards, the cockroaches. I think you outlive us all."
His dark eyes narrowed, flicking the pistol again.
"Get off before I decide to keep your woman."
His voice softened inexplicably, as if he'd not just threatened to kidnap Savina.
"Mind the current. It will push you up along the coast. Swim at an angle and you shall be fine."
Alejandro stood, pulling his wife to her feet.
"But our child?"
DeVoe shrugged again.
"I am happy to take her with me, but if I am honest, she stands a better chance in the sea with you."
He threw the boat into gear, nodding again toward the choppy water.
"I am leaving. The longer you put this off, the farther from land you will be."
Alejandro stepped to the rail, pulling Savina with him. He gazed sadly at the flickering city lights, so near, yet so very far away. Taking little Umbelina in his arms, he blew in her face so she'd hold her breath, then jumped, willing himself not to think of the sharks that hunted these waters at night.
Santiago de Cuba.
General Zayda de la Guardia's driver stepped on the squealing brakes, bringing the rusted Lada sedan to a stop in front of the abandoned poultry house. 50 feet wide and 200 feet long, the old hulk of a barn was the easternmost of four identical houses. They were all built sometime in the early 30s to provide chicken for the many casinos and fancy restaurants that had crowded the island. It was just before 5:30 in the morning, almost 2 hours until sunrise, but the general had his people on a strict timetable. Work continued throughout the night. The air was hot and sticky. It always was on the island, though sometimes it was much hotter and far stickier. The smell of ammonia from the nearby sewage lagoon bit to LaGuardia's nose, causing his eyes to tear up as soon as he opened the door. It couldn't be helped. Something had to be done with 3 decades of chicken manure. Generators and pumps wheezed and slurped, keeping the slop at bay in the toxic soup of the burbling lagoon. Time had reduced the other 3 barns to little more than skeletons, but De La Guardia had made this one much more substantial. Thick timbers buttressed the plywood retaining wall that kept the sewage lagoon from reaching the barn, and his men had fitted the interior with blackout screening, cobbled together from scraps of whatever they could find. Bits of weathered Soviet-era lumber and repurposed roofing material were tacked up on the walls. The ladder finally came to a stop. The driver set the parking brake and rushed around to open the door. De La Guardia could never remember the man's name. It was Russian.
Madik or Madiv or some other boringly Slavic name.
A remnant of Soviet soldiers who had fathered many children on the island. These men had married their Cuban paramours long enough to give them a Russian surname, then promptly abandoned them when they were recalled to the motherland. This young driver knew of the secret bunker, but he was too terrified to pose any threat in the short term. The long term would take care of itself. In any case, the man would wait in the car. De La Guardia had considered running a chicken operation in the other barns, but such an endeavor would mean turning soldiers into chicken farmers, and he feared that chicken farmers would not make good co-conspirators. The front door was unlocked. One of De La Guardia's soldiers, dressed in civilian clothing, hastily put out a cigarette and braced to attention. The periphery of the general's flashlight beam illuminated glossy female legs on the pages of a pornographic magazine. It seemed the guard had attempted to bury it in a mound of decades-old chicken dung when he'd heard the squealing brakes. De La Guardia raised an eyebrow at the magazine and growled a few words about the dereliction of duty, but he left it at that. Like the driver, this man didn't have enough value to warrant a formal rebuke. Under normal circumstances, soldiers could rest easy under the notion that anyone with enough authority to have them shot was likely sleeping off a night of overindulgence, probably snoring beside his mistress. But Zayda de la Guardia was a man on a mission that saw him dressed in a cheap cotton shirt and riding around in a rusty Lada that was older than he was. The only thin thing about the piggish general was the mustache above a mouth that seemed a few centimeters too long for even his wide face. The dark Spanish eyes, inherited from his great-grandfather, were small, like specks on a dinner plate. His thick black hair was combed up in a slight pompadour, like the photograph of his father that his mother kept above her dining room table. Where Colonel Miguel de la Guardia's dashing looks had seen him rise in the Revolutionary Army, Zayda had been promoted for the opposite reason. He was smart and driven, to be sure, but his odd look made certain that he could never outshine the Castros, an offense that had been the downfall of many handsome men in Cuban politics. Where Zayda's father had looked like a man to lead other men, the younger de la Guardia's visage said he would simply kill them if they didn't get out of his way. It didn't hurt that Zayda's father had been a hero of the revolution, murdered in his prime. De La Guardia looked the sentry up and down just to make him nervous. "Ring down to Dr. Plasencia," he snapped. "I want to see him at once." The guts of the building were hidden beneath a trapdoor of rough lumber in an earthen bunker under the old barn. Right now, only a ladder led down from the trapdoor, but De La Guardia had arranged for the crane that would bring out his prize in coming days. The sentry stammered, staring into the empty building.
"I would be most happy to do so, General, but Dr. Plasencia is not here."
De La Guardia's stomach began to knot.
"Where is he?" "This I do not know, General. He's not been here for the better part of 2 days."
The general spun on his heels, stalking outside to his ladder. He snatched a mobile phone from his pocket and punched in a number as he walked. A youthful Cuban Coast Guardsman answered immediately, audibly bracing when the general informed him who he was. De La Guardia launched into his demand.
"Radar signatures of vessels heading toward Miami. What do you see?"
"We observed one approximately 4 hours ago, Comrade General," the Coast Guardsman said. "It was small, moving quickly, like an inflatable or other small craft. We believe this vessel met up with a larger, faster vessel near Cayo de Sal, which continued toward Florida.
At present it is stopped 2 kilometers offshore from Marathon Key. De La Guardia sputtered, furious. No one thought to intercept this vessel in Cuban waters? Our patrols have all moved to the lee side of the island, out of the predicted path of the hurricane.
I see, De La Guardia said, grinding his teeth. Tell me, what is this vessel doing at this very moment?
It is motionless, Comrade General, the Coast Guardsman said. The man's voice trailed off. My apologies, it appears to be moving again.
Toward the shore?
No, sir, the Coast Guardsman said. On a bearing toward the Bahamas.
I want this boat stopped, De La Guardia fumed. I do not care if you have to invade Nassau.
He ended the call before the Coast Guardsman could protest. De La Guardia checked his watch, then punched a second number into his mobile. The man on the other end of the line picked up on the third ring.
Where are you? De La Guardia snapped.
Precisely where you sent me, the voice whispered, absent the fawning deference others showed.
You have not finished, then?
I have not.
That is too bad, De La Guardia said. I have another mission, Marathon Key. How long until you can get there?
A half an hour if we leave at once, the man on the other end of the line said.
Make it 20 minutes, De La Guardia said. What am I looking for?
A very wet man clambering up from the beach, De La Guardia said. His wife and child may accompany him. At this moment, I believe he is swimming from a boat that has deposited them approximately 2 kilometers offshore.
Swimming, the calm man repeated as if taking notes. How old is the child?
The phone crackled with static, as it often did over Cuban telecom systems. What does that matter? The general snapped.
One or two, perhaps.
A contemplative sigh.
2 kilometers is a long swim with a baby.
Yes, yes, so it is, De La Guardia said, struggling to keep the pitch of his voice from rising.
This traitor must be stopped. I will send a secure message with the particulars. Let me talk to Fuentes.
We split up, the man said, his voice registering a hint of disgust. It was saying something if Colonel Joaquin Mirabal, a cold man who hunted and killed other human beings for a living, considered Fuentes a soulless animal, the very qualities for which De La Guardia employed both of them.
Very well, the general said. I will call Fuentes directly. Get on with your job, Joaquin. This traitor must be stopped.
The sharks will probably get him, Mirabal offered.
See that they do, De La Guardia said. One way or another.
Key Largo, Florida. Ted Schoonover saw the little girl first, standing in the surf, backlit by the rising sun. Her shadow was absurdly long across the swath of golden sand that stretched below the line of condos. Black hair plastered to her chubby little face, she stood at the tide line, water draining from a sagging cloth diaper. Schoonover and his wife didn't have children, so he was no expert, but this one looked about 2 years old, maybe younger. A man staggered out of the water behind her, dragging a sputtering, half-conscious woman by the arms. Moving woodenly, he dropped the woman on the dry sand and then collapsed to his knees beside the child. He'd obviously deposited the girl on the shore and gone back for the woman. Cubans, Schoonover thought. Almost dead Cubans. He dropped his tape measure, hurtled over the row of newly planted palmetto shrubs, and sprinted to help the exhausted family. In his mid-30s, Schoonover was much too young to be as rich as he was. He'd lived in Florida for the past 6 years, earning his first million in real estate shortly after he'd separated from the Air Force. A former F-22 pilot, he could have flown in civilian life, but driving what was essentially a winged commuter bus back and forth across the sky at 40,000 feet was the last thing he wanted to do after the high-speed, low-drag stuff he'd grown used to in the military. Luckily, it turned out that risking his ass in real estate kept his blood pumping nearly as fast as prepping for a 7G turn. Schoonover had made it to the exhausted family in half a dozen long strides. He pantomimed drinking something, then pointed toward the condos. His Spanish was usually passable, but in the heat of the moment he couldn't manage to dredge up a single word beyond agua. The wet man surprised him by speaking accented English. His voice was breathless and raspy.
Water, he said, nodding emphatically. Yes, please, for my little girl and my wife. My name is Alejandro Basencia.
He looked up and down the beach.
There were spotlights a short time ago shining across the water. Did you see them?
Schoonover shook his head. I didn't see anything, but I just got here to check on my property. Presencia gulped in another breath. He gave an uneasy nod, continuing to look over his shoulder.
I was a pilot for the Cuban Air Force, and an aeronautical engineer.
Tears streamed from his sad brown eyes. The man swallowed hard, summoning up the energy to continue.
I have information, vital to the United States. I wish to request asylum for my family.
Schoonover ran a hand through his hair, still wet from a morning shower. I'm not sure how that would work, he said. But I'm a former pilot myself. He shook the Cuban's hand. Welcome to the United States, brother. I can call the police for you if you want. The man shook his head, hugging his wife closer.
Please, no. Cuban intelligence has many contacts inside Miami police. I would prefer to speak with someone higher.
Schoonover clapped his hands and pointed an index finger at the Cuban. You know what, he said. I got a buddy from the Air Force Academy. He'll know what we should do. Chapter 1. Virginia. Jericho Quinn knew the sound of fear when he heard it. As back against the door of the Cracker Barrel restaurant north of Dulles International Airport, he took a scant moment to survey the parking lot, homing in on the direction of the scream. It was early, a few minutes after 6 in the morning. The breakfast rush was just starting, the lot less than half full. Beside Quinn, Marine Master Sergeant Jacques Thibodeau froze as well, his tremendous bulk eclipsing the rising sun of a Washington, D.C. to the east. The big Marine tugged down his tan baseball cap, a recent addition to his wardrobe, and rubbed a freshly shaven jaw that was sharp enough to cut glass. He turned his head slightly to search the lot with his good eye. The other, covered with a black patch, had been injured at Quinn's side in a firefight in Bolivia. One Marine and one Special Agent of Air Force OSI, the two men were accustomed to moving toward the sound of danger, but not blindly or without any strategy.
What do you reckon, Chair Force? The big Marine said,
rarely missing an opportunity to chide Quinn for his chosen branch of service. Jacques Thibodeau was originally from Louisiana, and his Cajun accent and playful attitude came through loud and clear.
I count three goons standing by that red Mustang.
Yep, Quinn said. He moved his head along with his eyes as he scanned so he wouldn't miss any details. He'd shaved after his 0500 workout, but his cheeks were already beginning to show a dark stubble. This, combined with his scruffy hair, gave him an unkempt, predatory look that was intensified by its contrast with the recruiting poster-sharp Marine.
There are two more coming up from behind, he added, moving again.
50 meters away, a young couple stood facing the three men in forest green t-shirts on a small grass island in the middle of the restaurant parking lot. Quinn couldn't be sure, but it looked as though the couple had just gotten out of the Mustang. The tallest of the three men had squared off, shoulders flared like a cobra, and fists doubled at his sides, spoiling for a fight. The sandy-haired kid from the Mustang raised both hands. His Spitfire girlfriend wasn't helping matters, peeking around from behind him and giving an earful to the three aggressors. Two others, also in green t-shirts, made their way toward the little group from between the parked cars.
Get a load of their matching clothes, Thibodeau muttered. Looks like a bunch of Batman villains. You reckon that one with the blonde dreadlocks could be a girl?
Yep, Quinn said again. He zipped up his armored black leather motorcycle jacket as he stepped around a row of rocking chairs so he could hop off the end of the restaurant's long covered porch. Conventional wisdom dictated he leave the jacket unzipped to provide easier access to the Kimber 10mm pistol in the holster over his right kidney,
but Quinn didn't want to introduce a gun into what was likely just a fistfight. The leather jacket was heavy enough to provide an extra level of protection and supple enough to lift out of the way with his non-dominant hand should the pistol become necessary. The weather was warm, but he'd worn the jacket and Kevlar-lined tobacco jeans anyway.
"Damn it," Thibodeau spat as they neared the altercation. "I don't want to hit a girl if there's any way around it. Do me a favor, Chair Force. You hit her if she needs hitting."
Quinn shot his friend a look, but didn't say anything. Jacques had a tendency to philosophize up to and even during a fight. Luckily, he never seemed to require an answer, just a listening ear. Quinn had trained and fought alongside the big Marine countless times over the last half decade, enough times to know he would get down to business when the time came, no matter who he had to hit. The hard truths of real-world conflict had taught both men to employ the same basic strategy: surprise, speed, and overwhelming force. The Cajun relied on his size and tremendous strength, where Quinn's boxing and jiu-jitsu background gave him more finesse. Quinn noted a University of Maryland Terrapin sticker beside a decal of a Union Jack on the Mustang's bumper. None of the group looked much older than 20, and he thought maybe this was some beef over school rivalry. Muncie was close enough to hear the invective spewing from the green shirt crowd, though. It was clear this was something different than a fight over football.
"Here now,"
Thibodeau barked, adopting the disciplinary tone he used on his seven sons.
"Looks like we got ourselves a misunderstanding."
He sidestepped to the right while Quinn moved left, flanking the group. The green shirts didn't have enough sense to care. The tallest of the five, their apparent leader, continued to focus intently on the Mustang driver. He addressed Thibodeau without looking up.
"All ass, Grandpa," he said. "We got this."
Quinn took a step closer, less than 10 feet away now, a hair nearer to the leader than Jacques.
"You got what? 5 against 2? Looks like assault to me."
The leader's apparent aide-de-camp took an aggressive step toward Quinn, met his eye, and then froze, trying to build up his nerve. He was smart enough to stop, but couldn't keep from yapping like a dog.
"You're not cops," the kid sneered. "No, you'd have told us already. And anyway, like you said, there are 5 of us, so you should go."
The Mustang driver kept his hands raised. He spoke with a decidedly educated British accent.
"I've never spoken with these people in my life. Apparently they think I'm some kind of fascist."
The green shirt leader opened his mouth to respond, but the girl behind the Mustang driver began to scream at him again, defending the honor of her boyfriend in language strong enough to make even Thibodeau grimace. The leader glanced sideways at Thibodeau, his face screwed into a dismissive sneer.
"I thought I told you to get your ass out of here, old man."
Thibodeau shrugged, letting the comment about his age slide. Neither he nor Quinn had reached 40 yet. He maneuvered so the nearest thug was between him and the hood of the Mustang.
"How about you explain to me what's going on here, boss?" Thibodeau said.
The chubby girl in dreadlocks pointed a finger at Thibodeau.
"You're either with us or you're pro-fascist."
"Just anti-dumbass," Thibodeau said.
"You talk like you're from the South," the girl said. "Pretty sure you're a fascist, too."
"Nope," Thibodeau said, heaving a long sigh.
"Well, shithead he sure is," she said.
The Brit raised his hands even higher.
"Why do you all keep saying that?"
The leader began to breathe through his nose, a sure sign that he'd worked himself up to attack. The entire group looked and acted like amateurs, but Quinn had learned a long time ago that amateur elbows to the nose hurt just as bad as elbows belonging to trained professionals. Quinn's hands came up to his chest, palms out, a purely tactical move, not one of contrition. There was no signal between Quinn and Thibodeau, but he knew that Thibodeau would spring into action, too. They'd decided early on what they would and would not tolerate from these people, or anyone else, for that matter. Quinn drove forward, straight through the leader's startled aide-de-camp, taking just enough time to throw a lightning-fast 1-2-3 combination of left jab, right cross, and left uppercut. The last punch was overkill, but Quinn was already committed. He yanked the Brit out of the way with his right hand, throwing him to the ground in the process. The green shirt leader threw a single glancing blow to the Brit's chest, but quickly reverted into the posturing phase. Quinn slapped him on the ear, driving him sideways into another right cross as the third green shirt in line stepped up. This one fancied himself an actual fighter. He squared off in a fists-up, Sherlock Holmes-style bare-knuckle boxing stance. Quinn was vaguely aware of Thibodeau bouncing someone's head off the hood of the Mustang while he wore the screaming, dreadlocked girl like a banshee backpack. Jacques yowled, probably bitten. He was always getting bitten. He had a tendency to pull his punches when he fought females, even when they were trying to kill him. He let loose a string of Cajun curses and reached over his shoulders in an attempt to peel the screeching woman off his back. Finally succeeding, he raised her high above his head. It looked like something out of a WWE SmackDown match. Quinn wanted to watch what happened next, but his opponent turned out to be slightly more skilled than his stance suggested. Quinn loved boxing, and he rarely stood toe-to-toe in a real-world fight. But an explosive attack might kill this hapless kid, so Quinn circled instead of crashing in. He put the kid's back to Jacques just in time to watch the big Cajun toss the woman a little too gently to the ground. It did the trick, though, and she gave up for the moment. The door to a nearby Mazda creaked open, and a sixth green shirt climbed out. This one was at least 6'4" and almost as thick as Thibodeau. Jacques chuckled.
"Oh, good," he said. "I've leveled up in this game."
Quinn's green shirt feinted with a left jab a little too deeply, presenting the point of his chin on a silver platter. Quinn rewarded the mistake with a cross elbow to the nose, dispensing with the Marquess of Queensbury rules now that Thibodeau might need some help. He needn't have worried. Jacques drove a knee into the big guy's groin, and then, when the guy doubled over, used the fender of the Mustang to great effect once again. Quinn took a step back, scanning for other attackers. That which didn't kill you often had friends waiting in the wings to kill you when you thought the fight was finished. All the idiots appeared to have shown themselves. With all six green shirts out cold or pretending to be, Thibodeau stooped to pick up the ball cap that the girl had knocked off his head. Quinn smiled.
"You should think about losing the hat. It's just not you." "That's the whole point of a chair force," Jacques said. "I wear the cover to make me look less like a Marine."
Quinn's smile broadened.
"Let me know how that works out for you. And don't keep calling it a cover if you want to sound like a civilian."
He reached down to help the Brit to his feet.
"You okay?"
"I'm fine," the kid said, his jaw hanging open. "That was nothing short of amazing." He looked up. "I must tell you, there is not a racist bone in my body. Why did these people think I was a fascist?"
"Let's ask them."
Thibodeau goaded the initial instigator with the toe of his motorcycle boot.
"What's your beef with Mr. Mustang here?" "He's got a Confederate flag," the green shirt leader said.
The Brit looked confused.
"No, I don't."
On a hunch, Quinn stepped around to look at the Mustang's bumper, whistling Jacques over at what he saw. Thibodeau rolled his good eye at the green shirt.
"Not that a Stars and Bars bumper sticker is worth getting your ass kicked over, but that's a British Union Jack, genius."
Chapter 2. Soon after they'd made sure the British student and his girlfriend were back in the Mustang and safely on their way, Quinn and Thibodeau stood beside their BMW GS adventure motorcycles at the other end of the parking lot. They'd need to leave quickly if they didn't want to become embroiled in a quagmire of statements and interviews with law enforcement. Quinn slipped a beaked, awry dual sport helmet over his head. The helmet was gunmetal gray to match his bike, with death dealer war axes airbrushed on each side to match his personality. Thibodeau threw a leg over his own bike, which was a more vibrant red and black.
"I don't mean to put too fine a point on it, mon ami," he said, helmet poised above his head. "But I didn't exactly hit that gal back there."
"She hit the pavement."
Tomato, tomato, Quinn said, pushing the Beamer's ignition switch with his right thumb. 2 minutes later, he rolled on the throttle and made a left turn onto Old Ox Road toward Reston. As usual, Thibodeau's philosophical meanderings began to pour through the Cardo Bluetooth speaker inside Quinn's helmet almost as soon as they were on the road. You ask me, marry Ronnie, have a passel of kids, and channel your inner grandpa. You mean my inner dad, Quinn said, taking the bait. Nah, Thibodeau said. Skip the dad part and just be a grandpa. I've decided not to sweat the normal stuff dads are supposed to worry about. Camille hates it. Quinn chuckled, chewing on that. I never figured you for an inner grandpa, he said. An inner child, maybe. Well, I tell you, Chair Force, the big Cajun drawled, passing Quinn's motorcycle on the left. Turns out my inner grandpa's pretty cool, but my inner child is a mean little bastard. Quinn couldn't help but smile. Mine too, he said. His cell chirped in the headset, rescuing him from further discussion. He tapped the controls on the outside of his helmet, then rode forward to make a telephone gesture to Jacques, letting him know he was handling a call. A familiar voice spilled through the speakers. Quinn smiled, recognizing an old Air Force Academy squadron mate from the Tough 20 Trolls. Teddy Schoonover had gone the pilot route, while Quinn pursued a career as a combat rescue officer and led a team of PJs, the Air Force's elite pararescue personnel. By the time Quinn had made the switch from Special Ops to the Office of Special Investigations, Schoonover was teaching a new cadre of pilots to fly F-22s at Tyndall Air Force Base in Florida. The two men saw each other at periodic reunions, and they still kept in touch via the close association of men and women who'd endure the same beast summers during their freshman year in the thin air of Jack's Valley above Colorado Springs. Well, hey, Ted, Quinn said. He kept his voice low and even, despite how happy he was to hear from a former classmate. The Academy had a way of cementing friendships, and Schoonover was one of the best. They exchanged quick pleasantries, skipping the usual banter about the food at Arnold Hall and any number of things neither of them missed about the USAFA. Schoonover was rattled and jittery, no small thing for a man accustomed to strapping himself into a hunk of metal flying faster than the speed of sound. Quinn listened without interrupting. I'll do what I can, he said when Schoonover finished. I'll check with a friend at Customs and Border Protection. I'd appreciate that, Jericho, Schoonover said. This guy acts like somebody had the proverbial red dot on his forehead. Know what I'm saying? He's scared shitless. And I don't mind telling you, that's got me spooked. According to him, Cuban intelligence has Metro-Dade wired from the inside, if you know what I mean. I've got a lot of friends in local law enforcement, and I've heard the same thing from them. That's a strong possibility, Quinn said, thinking of what he knew of Cuba's intelligence directorate. He glanced at his left mirror, shoulder checked to make doubly sure his lane was clear, and accelerated around a pokey Ford Fiesta as he continued to speak. This Placencia guy, he seems legitimate. I think so, yeah, Schoonover said. There was noise in the background and muffled conversation as Schoonover spoke with someone else, presumably the Cuban refugee. He came back on the line a moment later. He keeps saying he has information vital to the United States. Listen, Jericho, Customs and Border Protection is all well and good, but don't you know anyone in... He lowered his voice. I don't know. The intelligence community? Quinn smiled in spite of his friend's anxiety. I might know someone, he said. Let me make a couple of calls, then I'll get back to you. Right away, Schoonover said. I'm serious, Jericho. There's something about this guy. I mean, he was scared enough to swim in from a mile offshore carrying a little kid. I'll get back to you in a flash. Quinn hit the Cardo control on the left side of his helmet to disconnect. He voice-dialed the next call. 5 minutes later, Veronica Ronnie Garcia repeated Quinn's words back to him from her cubicle on the Russian desk at CIA headquarters just 15 miles away. Cubans, you say? Ronnie, the product of a Russian father and a Cuban mother, and Jericho Quinn's girlfriend, had a special affinity for refugees who were attempting to escape the thumb of the Castro regime, since she'd done it herself as a teenager. Now her voice was rough with nostalgia.
Of course we'll help this guy. I've got a friend who's a case officer in Miami. I'll let ICE know the agency will run point on this one, for the time being, at least. He can arrange a neutral pickup and get the family to a safe house.
Her tone grew softer, less businesslike.
Jericho, tell your academy buddy to be careful. Miami stinks with Cuban DI operatives. Most of the time, my outfit underestimates how sharp they are. If this refugee knows something important to the regime and they know he's run off, they'll be on his tail muy pronto. You got me, Mango?
I'll pass that along, Quinn said, then relayed the address to the condo where Ted Schoonover was waiting.
Good deal,
Ronnie said, the richness of her accent coming through the phone. All this talk of the old country has me jonesing for some crema de plátano. How about you take me to Cubano's in Silver Spring tonight? Quinn smiled at the memory of their first quasi-date. He was very nearly banned from the place for a hellacious fight where he'd demolished the restaurant's men's room while defending himself from an attack. In the end, Ronnie had smoothed things over with some rowdy and highly suggestive Cuban jokes with the management. There seemed no end to what she could accomplish with a smile and a few bats of her dark lashes.
Who could say no to plantain soup? Quinn said.
Okay, I promised Ted I'd call him right back. I'll let him know you're setting something up through your people and he can rest easy.
Copy that, Garcia said. Who loves you, Mango?
Quinn shot a glance at Thibodeau, who rode just ahead and to the left in the same lane. Glad he couldn't hear, then whispered into the helmet mic,
Voodoo. Damn right me do, Garcia said. Me too, Quinn said.
Quinn redialed Ted Schoonover as soon as he ended the call with Garcia. It rang once, then went immediately to voicemail. He tried again with the same result. He'd expected Schoonover to pick up on the first ring. The fact that he'd let two calls go unanswered gnawed at Quinn's gut. And if he'd learned anything over the course of his violent career, it was that his gut never lied. Chapter 3. 6 minutes earlier. Most operatives of Dirección de Inteligencia focused their efforts on recruiting agents from among the youth of Miami. Younger Cuban Americans tended to lean much further left than their parents. DI's chief recruitment weapons were a healthy capacity for salesmanship, and in the case of female operatives, an oozingly stereotypical Latina sexuality. All of these provocateurs had been trained in defensive and offensive combat at the spy school known as Camp Matanzas, but few bothered with firearms, preferring social engineering to gunplay. Joaquin Mirabal was not a recruiter. He was a hunter. The white scar that crossed diagonally from forehead to chin like a jagged white lightning bolt on his angular face was a testament to that. Heavily influenced by his KGB trainers, Colonel Mirabal armed each of the other three members of his team with suppressed pistolets Bashumni. The silenced handgun was based on the tried-and-true Makarov 9x18mm. It had come into service in the late 1960s, a decade before Mirabal was born, but was still issued to Russian Spetsnaz and FSB operatives who needed to kill quietly. While not completely silent, the small handguns were effective, and a little gunfire rarely raised much suspicion in southern Florida so long as the shots were kept to a minimum. An avid hunter of big game since his early postings in Africa, Colonel Mirabal was by far the best shot in his four-person squad. As such, he gave himself a little more latitude with his choice of sidearm. Instead of the PB, he carried a tiny Beretta Bobcat in .22 caliber, outfitted with a small suppressor not much larger than his thumb. The can, as the Americans called it, was just under 8 centimeters long. Subsonic ammunition and a locked slide rendered the weapon as quiet as any he had ever used. Of course, he had to get close to employ it, but that was rarely a problem for a true hunter. He left the slide unlocked to allow for follow-up shots, but the gun was still no louder than a vigorous slap. Each member of his team carried a blade for close work, or if they were making a statement. Mirabal's own knife was a simple hunting affair he'd been given by a tracker and friend in Angola. It was a homely thing, with a weathered acacia handle and a carbon steel blade that rusted easily if he didn't keep it oiled. but it held an edge, and he got it bloody often enough that remembering to oil it wasn't an issue. The muscular Mateo Duran and voluptuous Serafina Lopez both carried heavy Soviet FSB daggers called karatils, or punishers. Guns and knives were easy to conceal inside heavy nylon fanny packs, conveniently popular with the older set in Florida who didn't want to fish items out of their pockets. Estrada, the youngest of the four at 22, carried a geologist's rock pick instead of a blade. It was roughly the same dimensions as a hammer, too big for the fanny pack. Estrada hung it from his nylon belt, where it blended easily with the blue and gray of his board shorts. The heavy pick was brutally lethal and had the added benefit of sending a clear message to any defectors who watched the news. They might assume a dead body containing the round-nosed bullets from a Makarov pistol were from a Cuban assassin. But the spike of a rock pick through the teeth was a definite reminder to everyone to keep their own mouths shut. It was a practice that even Mirabal, who had seen much blood and bone over the course of his 46 years, found disgusting. But Estrada didn't seem to mind, so the duty fell to him. As soon as he'd received the call from General de la Guardia, Mirabal brought up a weather report on his mobile phone while Duran drove. He needed something more specific than the basic weather report, so he used a website called windy.com that displayed forecasts for wind speed, direction, wave height, and ocean currents. More important, it gave Mirabal the measurements for right now, not just the forecast, allowing him to make the necessary minute-by-minute computations. Once de la Guardia had relayed the last known radar location of the traitor's boat, it had been a straightforward process to deduce where the man would likely come ashore. Even the mightiest swimmers were subject to the wind and tide. The traitor had jumped off the boat somewhere off Marathon Key, but the currents would sweep him northward toward Miami. If he was any kind of a swimmer at all, and only a good swimmer would brave these dark, shark-infested waters with his wife and child, Alejandro Plasencia would make landfall on Key Largo. Mirabal worked time and distance calculations for drift as if he were charting a sailing course rather than trying to determine where the victim of his next bullet would founder on the sandy shores of the United States. Duran parked their rented black Silverado pickup on a small side road just beyond a tennis court in the neighborhood up the beach from where Mirabal guessed Plasencia would make landfall. The sun was coming up and people were beginning to stir. Few took the paper anymore, streaming what little news they read over the internet. But some of the older ones, mostly women with brightly dyed hair and big Hollywood sunglasses, would be out soon to take their morning walks. Mirabal made sure his team dressed to blend in. All the men wore pastel board shorts and polo shirts. Serafina's tennis dress would show off toned legs and distract any would-be witnesses from the specifics of her face. The Silverado was classy enough to fit in with the rest of the bourgeois Yankee cars and trucks. "I see him, Joaquin," Serafina whispered from the shadows. Her voice buzzed against her left fist as she held the portable infrared scope to her eye. She meant no disrespect by addressing her superior officer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.